So in this talk, I'm going to talk about a specific class of equation that is generally known as phase field equations and how we can use parallel space-time approach to solve them. This work was done by me and my colleague Biswajit at Iowa State University and the colleagues at University of Utah, Melinda and Masado. Our guide is Dr. Hari Sundar and Dr. Bhaskar. So like we have been saying that in the traditional method, we do the spatial discretization by either finite difference, finite element, volume, or lattice Boltzmann spectral method. And for temporal discretization, we generally use the finite difference type of approach where we use backward Euler or Krang-Nicolson or RK4 method. So the bottleneck that we face in this type of method, like we saw in the previous talk also, that at every time step, we need some type of expressive synchronization, and that can cause a lot of time in the communication and synchronization, and adaptivity in time is not that trivial. So what we do is generally, so our approach is to consider a space and time as one full block and solve them at once. So for us, the time acts like an advection operator because it has first derivative in that direction. And I will also show in this talk that switching from higher order basis function from linear to quadratic, it essentially acts as doing a higher order time stepping, where like quadratic basis function will act like an RK3 type of approach. And this gives a very nice way to exploit parallelism in both space and time, and we can do some a posteriori error-based estimates to selectively refine the regions of interest in both space and time. So this work we have published based on the a posteriori estimates for a simple heat equations in the paper. Let's take a general class of equations, which is like nonlinear advection diffusion reaction equation. So this is a time evaluation equation where you have a time operator with an advection operator, and this is a nonlinear diffusion operator. And then you have some reaction term and some forcing function that is there. And you have some initial guess at t equal to zero equal to at some u naught. So if you write in a coupled space-time way, so the ut plus a dot dot u, this whole you can write it as an space-time block. And if you write it in a complete space-time block, so we can see that so this ux at t equal to zero, u naught, this will become a boundary condition on the time domain. And for simplicity, we are assuming that on all the spatial domain, we have a Dirichlet boundary condition. And so our advection operator a grad as t will become a is like advection in all the three direction, and in time it's one. This is a Laplacian space-time is grad x, grad y, grad z, and also in time. So in FEM formulation, we use FEM to solve this. So in standard Galerkian form, we do a weakening of the equation to get a Galerkian form. So, but we know that for a finite element method, the advection we need to stabilize any advection method, term, we need some stabilization. In the traditional way, like using Galerkian least square or SUPG, they are limited to linear basis function. And we cannot exploit the higher order basis function using this type of stabilization. So for this, we use something that is known in the literature as additional multi-scale method, which basically says that we split the equation into the two coarse scale and fine scale, and we solve for the coarse scale, and we approximate the fine scale as some residual of the coarse scale. So in terms of in fluid dynamics, this is most commonly known as something like large LES type of treatment, where you approximate the fine scale based on the properties of the coarse scale. And this stabilization, the stabilization parameter has been proved by inverse Green's function in the literature, as it takes some forms of like this, like given by the equation 6. And so to test the validity of our approach, we took method of manufacture solution where we took 2D in space and 1D in time, and we have a domain of 0, 1, and this is the the equation is valid as e raised to minus t by 2 sin pi x sin pi y. The advection is kept as a constant as one in x and y as 1, 1, and this is our reaction term varying as a nonlinear operator, and this is the diffusion term is a nonlinear operator, simple nonlinear operator with a parameter k star. So this k star we will tune to vary the mesh speckled number. So here is the convergence study that we get. So if we have a very high peclet case where the diffusivity is very low, or even a very low peclet case with very high diffusivity, we see that we get desired order of convergence for linear. We get second order convergence, and for quadratic, we get a third order convergence. So the error is calculated in the full space time block. So in order to test our approach with this type of continuous Galerkin method, we took a hyperbolic problem where the diffusivity is exactly zero, and this has been found very hard for a continuous Galerkin method to predict. So we took a very simple 1+1D a domain where you can see a wave, it is moving, it is complete advection, it is moving in a 0 to 1 block, and it's the boundaries are periodic. So on the right, you see the solution of this hyperbolic problem. You see, so we have the full time block is accounts for around 10 periods. So you can see this type of 10 stripes going on. So basically, the other 10 cycles. And if we try to measure the dispersion that our schemes occur. So with linear basis function, we see that there is a huge lot of dispersion. And with if we just switch from linear to quadratic, we see that it behaves in a much nicer way. And even if we measure the undersuit that we are receiving, so the quadratic behaves as a much better way. We have seen with our experiment that the linear behaves in a very similar way as a standard Krag-Nicolson. But for quadratic, we are still experimenting we have to still benchmark it with some RKA type of schemes. How much dispersion does this occur? So now moving on to the phase field equations, that is the main topic of this talk. So the phase field equations are very commonly used to model some phenomena like phase transformation, like melting and solidification, or a crystal growth in metals. Or when we talk about the phase separations or something like now has been commonly used for interface tracking where people have coupled Carnot-Hedyard with Navier-Stokes. So more or less we can categorize all these equations as some category of a nonlinear diffusion reaction equation. The main characteristic of these equations are they are very localized in a region in both space and time. So this accounts for a method where we can exploit the parallelism in both space and time and also adaptivity. So first let's take a look at the Allen-Kahn equation, which is used to model the phase transformation. So we have a phase field varying as given by the equation where we have f prime phi as some free energy function, these are like a gradient of the flow source. This is like epsilon is related to the interfacial energy and m is the mobility, and f is the free energy function. So if we take say example of a two concentric circle, so we see that the circle with the radius with the higher radius of curvature, which is the smaller circle, first shrinks, and then the circle with the lower radius of curvature with higher radius, then it begins to sink. So basically, we can think it as an ice melting into water. So we are seeing this type of behavior, and if we take something like an initial condition at the start, then a star shaped ice flake, and we see that it first turns into a circle and then it also diminishes. And these are the behavior that is consistent with those reported in the literature. That is, even if we do the sequential time stepping, we see that they are very similar behavior. Uh, So the reason it behaves in like this because these are the flow is motivated with the direction of the gradient. And so if you take some second model, the Kobayashi, which is used to model a crystal growth in the metal. So this is basically a two coupled set of equation where we have temperature and phi, the phase field, they are both solved simultaneously. So one is the D behaves like a diffusion tensor. And this K is the latent heat, and G, this reaction term is a complicated function of in both of phase field and temperature. So there are two variant of this. So first, if we consider D as a constant, with only the components in the diagonal direction. So this is something that is known as the isotropic diffusion. Or D can be something like a very complicated set of equation where this all epsilon is dependent upon the orientation, and orientation on theta, and theta in turn depends upon the phase field variables at each location. And there is something known as J that determines what is the anisotropy mode. It will be more clear when we see these results. So if we just take a very simple the isotropic diffusion case, so where we put a, so the phenomena is something like this. You put a very small pinch of solid into a supercooled state. So this crystal tends to grow. If we model this crystal growth as an isotropic diffusion, it maintains its curvature and it tends to grow in the form of circle. So we are, because it doesn't have any preferential direction to grow. So it sees all the direction as equally, and it that's why we see something that is growing as a circle. But if we do something like an anisotropic diffusion, where we put the same pinch of metal into a supercooled state, now in this it has some preferential direction that is determined by the diffusivity tensor, and for this we have said the eightfold symmetry. So that's why you can count there are eight different snowflake structure that is growing out of the So if we change it to something like 16, so we can see the 16 type of this snowflake structure that is growing out. So yeah, and so here you are seeing the variation of phi and temperature both, and these are solved in a coupled manner in both space and time. So coming to the third set of equation, which is Kahn-Hilliard equation. So above, both Kobayashi and Allen Kahn is mostly used to model the phase transformation. So there the mass is not conserved, but in Kahn-Hilliard equation, these are used to model the phase separation, where in theory the mass should be conserved. So these are basically the standard way of solving Kahn-Hilliard essentially is a fourth order differential equation in space. So the way we solve the Kahn-Hilliard equation is we split it into two different equation, and so that we can utilize the linear basis function also. Otherwise, it will not be possible to utilize the linear basis function. And so the way we solve it, we do again the BMS approximation, and we split the both phase field phi and mu into the coarse grain and the fine scale, and the fine scale is again approximated by the residual of the coarse scale term for both mu and phi. And so here is something like, so we start with a random mix of both in space, a random mix of two components that is seen at t equal to zero. And so as the time evolves, it tends to separate in the phases. And on the left, you can see this is a complete space-time block where at t equal to zero, we have this random distribution of two phase, which is one of the phase is at phi equal to minus one, and one of the phase is at phi equal to plus one. So, and it tends to separate as the time evolves. like I said earlier, it is a phase separation, so the mass would be conserved. So if we plot the mass at each time slice, we see that the mass, so we are observing the mass to be of the order of 10 to power minus 11. I would expect 10 to power, because 10 to power minus 11 loss, because the way we simulated it, the tolerance was said to be 10 to power minus 12. So I would not expect anything better than 10 to power minus 11 for the mass. And also the another characteristic of carnelian is that the total energy should decrease. So that is what we are observing. So the total energy is decreasing, the interfacial energy is growing, because as the time evolves, the phases start tends to form that a thin layer of interface. So this is what the theory is predicting. And the last point is that here if it tends to do something adaptivity, because as I mentioned that this is very localized in space and time both. So for this type of phase field equation, we can just track this interface. So and refine it near the interface. So on the left you are seeing an ice melting into water. And on the right, I'm plotting the same time slice. So we can see that we are doing adaptivity both in space and time, and we are refining only the regions that is of interest. Whereas far from the region of interface, we are doing coarsening in both space. We have coarse elements in both space and time. So this gives us a very nice way to do adaptivity in space and time. So there are some challenges that we need to be careful while implementing this type of 4D stuff. Something like traditional matrix-based methods that has been used becomes quite expensive. If we just consider in 4D for 1D or system like a heat equation, for quadratic basis function, elemental matrix size is something like 81 cross 81. And the memory required to store each elemental matrix is something like 52 KBs. But if we see any modern cluster, we use something like, we use Stampede 2, and this is common across all the modern cluster. The L1 cache is just 32 KB. So even our one local elemental matrix will not fit into the cache. And this slows down our this has a tremendous effect or a disastrous effect on our solve time. And that's why there is a need for something like matrix-free methods. So we did some preliminary test in evaluating the matrix-free in all the finite element operators in a matrix-free way for transient heat in 4D, and we saw something like 10x speed up for linear basis function and 100x for quadratic basis function. This is mainly because of the memory movement that we need to do for each elemental matrix assembly. But the challenge part is that the matrix-free preconditioner is not very studied or known, and it's hard to build such matrix-free preconditioners. But we are working on something geometric multigrid. Since we have tree-based data structures, so we can do we can do the traversals on the tree. And this also has a very good point of, it doesn't need a setup cost of algebraic multigrid, because we have observed that algebraic multigrid, at least with the PTC interface, going beyond 10,000 processors, it suffers a lot with the initial setup cost. And there was another issue that when we are solving this complicated nonlinear solvers, we have, we are also working on something like a pseudo time stepping, where this is approach that is being commonly used to solve steady state solution in the past, where you take some pseudo time step to make the system of equation as diagonal dominant, and that gives we can take this to build up some initial guess for the nonlinear solve. And all these it has been maintained in a public repository in DendroKT. The initials and the application is still in the private repository, but the the software over which we build this application is still in the public repository, and if somebody is interested, we can feel free to contact us. That's all from my side. Thanks.